Do we have a venomous animal in this box?
Yes, you do.
Let's see.
I am ambiguous, abundant, complex, sometimes harmful, but never hostile. I am my own supergroup.
I don't know what's going on. Ooh. Demantoid, a familiar friend. Demantoid garnet in asbestos. Chrysidolite fibers in asbestos. It looks like there's striations that run perpendicular. So there's like a ribbon of color that goes around the edge of this specimen and perpendicular to the ribbon. So these are chrysotile fibers that are all parallel to one another that causes that phenomenon of chatoyancy. So if I were to take this out of the box, I would probably want to have some gloves on, wash my hands afterwards, and maybe even have a mask on because sometimes these fibers can dislodge. And if you were to breathe one in, that would be no bueno.
Well, we're talking about supergroups and we've got double dose of asbestos here. Could we be dealing with amphiboles? I'm getting a thumbs up. We're talking about amphiboles, which is a supergroup. I think I know someone who can help me out in this situation. So amphiboles are a little bit complex. They're a little bit geologically involved. I'm going to bring someone on who is also geologically involved. She's a new face on the channel and we're very excited to meet her. Let's bring her on.
Poof.
Voila. Brittany is here. I brought Brittany on to help me out because amphiboles are, like I said, not really something that I'm super strong on, but you are a geologist, right?
Yes, I am a geologist. So I went to school at the University of Tennessee, Knoxville. That is where I got my degree in geology.
Can you tell me a little bit about amphiboles?
Since they are both in cases and there's several different types of amphiboles and that these are specifically related to asbestos, mm-hmm. Best to keep these in cases, but not all amphiboles are asbestos. With the amphibole group in general, their crystal habit is more prismatic and fibrous in general, but not all of it is going to be as harmful as the asbestos group within amphibole. But what it is initially is that it's an enosilicate, which is one of the seven major types of silicates, which make 95% of the Earth's crust.
So we're surrounded by amphiboles?
No,
okay.
Not amphiboles specifically, but
silicates, yes.
Okay, all right.
What's neat about the amphibole group is that one, it's an enosilicate, but two, there's another group called the pyroxenes that are also enosilicates. So pyroxenes, when they form, they both make chains. And the pyroxenes, they make single chains when they're crystallizing, but amphiboles, they make double chains. And that allows them to have their certain structure, which probably separates them more from having more of the fibrous as well as just the prismatic structure.
I was actually, I was gonna ask, yes. Is the fibrous structure, is that kind of referring to the crystals that are lending themselves to this chatoyant effect on this?
Yes, so within this particular specimen with the chrysidolite, the way how it's formed, it's parallel going this way. When fibers form, they're gonna be more, I would say, parallel than just random in general, just because it's a lot easier to form going in one direction instead of
all over the place. Right.
Everywhere.
Right. Okay.
Yes. I got the box.
You got the box?
I got the box.
You want to take the lid off for me? Oh, I've seen one of these before. So it seems like we're staying on the chatoyancy track because like we see in this guy, the same effect is present and these guys, but I don't have to wear gloves. These are tiger's eye. So it's the same effect. It's the thin parallel needle inclusions.
That's right. Yeah, so we see both similar effects in both. Within tiger's eye is also chrysidolite, but.
Okay.
So tiger's eye is a form of quartz, but within that quartz is chrysidolite. And over time and oxidation, what chrysidolite, this blue color, mm-hmm. It will oxidize to this like orangey brown yellow color. And then the color is known in its mineral form as limonite. So if it's not
so
oxidized.
So this is pre,
yes.
Okay, gotcha. So no oxygen contact yet.
Over time.
Over time.
It's not going to like snap instantaneously, oxidize into limonite. When it's not altered, it's known as hawk's eye.
Regardless of the animal, they're both eyes, right? Because we see the chatoyancy effect in both of them. So if this is all chrysidolite that's causing the tiger's eye, why is this one locked away in a box and we can freely touch these?
The major difference between these two is that these have quartz in them. So when it's forming, the quartz kind of takes over the chrysidolite and just kind of absorbs it as it's forming. And instead of the chrysotolite being like on the outer layer and exposed for us to breathe in, it is now essentially like covered,
integrated into
quartz.
It's emulsified.
Yes, and so it makes it perfectly fine to touch it, wear it, do whatever. Great. I would not eat it,
no,
of course,
well,
no,
sure,
in general.
I would avoid that.
Thank you.
Ooh, let's see what we have here.
I'm liking these different colors.
Yes, this is a lilac scapolite, but I don't think, because we're talking about amphiboles, I don't think that's the piece that we are interested in today. I think we want to know about the green tremolite, which you also have a little slice of, right?
Yes, within the amphibole group, one of the series within it is the tremolite and actinolite series. There's high concentrations of both magnesium and iron for this to be like an intermediate between tremolite and actinolite, which is really, really cool.
So normally it would be a higher concentration of one, iron or magnesium, but in this case it's high concentrations of both.
Indeed.
At the top of the episode, you mentioned pyroxenes versus amphiboles.
Yes.
Is there anything unique or inherent to their formations that makes them different or geologically significant?
Yes. So the difference besides pyroxenes forming as a single chain and amphiboles forming as a double chain is that when magma comes up and it starts to crystallize, there's going to be variance in time to when they crystallize. When magma first starts to crystallize, it'll create olivines. And then from there, it will create the pyroxenes.
Okay.
And then the amphiboles, and then biotite, which are all forms of silicates. There is this wonderful geologist known as Norman L. Bowen, who created the Bowen's reaction series. What he did in this series was kind of measuring the relationships between temperature and when minerals crystallize. He pieced together that, one, that they crystallize at certain temperatures. Two, there's some minerals that only form, like you won't find like olivines with like biotites within the same host rock, because they just crystallize at different temperatures.
It would never occur that way.
Just kind of helps identify, oh man, this rock has a lot of olivines. It must have crystallized at such and such temperature.
Okay.
Which it helps geologists identify the like kind of time scale of like when this magmatic eruption happened, the geological time scale in general, which is very helpful.
No, any kind of clues as to what happened thousands to millions of years ago geologically is extremely valuable. Taking a brief jump back into the realm of gemology versus geology. Tremolite gets its name from a locality in the Swiss Alps called the Tremola Valley. Actually, the rarest locality for it is in Tanzania.
Ooh. Oh, I wasn't expecting that.
It's an Oreo shake. So what we've got here is a nice lump of hornblende. So hornblende gets its name from some German rather than ancient Greek or Latin. It combines the words for deceiving and a word that refers to dark ore that has little to no value. Because it has pyrite in it sometimes, a lot of people thought, ooh, this ore has gold. Let's dig up as much of it as we can. Our black part is our hornblende.
So when you look at it through a microscope, it doesn't have like those really pretty beautiful colors. And most of the time, it was just black from its different varieties. And it's very difficult to identify even microscopically, like.
Really?
Yes. I mean, you could say like, oh, this is an amphibole, but like, what kind of amphibole?
Yeah,
like,
that doesn't really count.
You can open the last one.
Oh, thank you.
Yes.
Ooh, looky there.
Ooh.
Go ahead and pull that out. Oh yeah, that's a dense little boy.
Very dense. I like these tiny little white bands that are going on right here.
Mm-hmm.
Slightly banded, but not really.
I like
banded.
I like the luster on these flat planes over here. Mm-hmm. So they glint all at the same time. So what we have here is a nice lump of actinolite. This one actually comes from Austria. These flashing, glinting bands of luster are our actinolite. It's often found as small needle inclusions, like what we saw in the first specimen from today, in a lot of other gem material. And actually, if we get even smaller, so that we get downright fibrous with our actinolite, it's a different variety of actinolite called bisalite. Actinolite comes from Greek, ancient Greek, and it actually translates to ray
or beam.
It also seems to me that the actinolite that's in here is also very similar to this piece that we were talking about earlier, where it was the intermediate member between both the actinolite and tremolite members. Mm-hmm.
So have you got a favorite from today's poll that you want to give the viewers a closer look of?
I do like this piece just because it's just really, really cool. I really like the difference in between the hornblende and its matrix rock.
I choose the Tiger's Eye Sphere because it's classic, and also I really want to give you guys an opportunity, a chance to look at it from different angles because it really does flash pretty dramatically in a couple spots. Well, that's it for today, guys, on our special on the amphiboles of the geological and gemological world. Thank you so much, Brittany, for coming on and saving my life for this topic. If you guys liked what you saw, leave a comment. Tell us what your favorite specimen was, or if we missed out an amphibole, you can leave a comment and let us know. If you don't want to get caught unprepared like I did with amphiboles, you can learn about them and many other gemstones at our new website, gemstones.com. It's a fabulous resource for anyone who wants to learn a little bit more about what goes on beneath the surface of the earth. Don't forget to like, subscribe, and ring the bell, of course, so you don't miss out on future specials like this. And we'll see you next time. Thanks for watching.
Thank you.